What's up, everybody, and welcome into the Backliners podcast. It's Aggro and BaRRaCCuDDa as per usual, and as per usual, we knew it was coming, that the microphone or the audio settings were not working. But now?
You fix it?
I fix it. Yep. So easy for me. Welcome in, everybody. Sorry we didn't have a show last week. Had family in town, meeting the little guy, all that kind of stuff. But it turned out to be a fairly crazy week.
Yeah, what happened?
Well, you know, you got dropped. My God got dropped. all the stuff. I feel like this is an important thing to address really quick. Jay in chat asks, is the audio thing a bit or real? It is actually real. And that's pathetic it is real, but it is. I test every day. I should have done it today. Maybe next week I'm going to show myself testing the audio and then you'll all see that it doesn't work because it actually doesn't, but I do test it. Anyways, if you haven't heard, that would be a crazy way to haven't been paying attention to SPL news at all and like me just quickly hitting it there is you're like, what?
Somebody just got gut punched out there, unfortunately. Yeah.
Unfortunately, yes. BaRRaCCuDDa was dropped from the Highland Ravens. They picked up the three-time
right on my head.
Steven Zappas. Yeah, they dropped you from your your ankle, so to speak. Barry, what happened from your perspective that led to this?
Well, basically, scrims weren't going that great since we've been back, and I was on the page of it just being because we haven't scrimmed or really played Smite in 2 months. And I did feel like scrims were getting better as they went on. And funnily enough, I got dropped on Tuesday. And that Monday, I was streaming. And I said on stream, those are the best scrims we've had since we've been back. And then I got dropped the next day, which was really funny to me.
It's kind of like how, real quick, there's like a real life sports equivalent. Drew Holiday, a great basketball player, like was quoted in a story saying he wanted to finish his career in Milwaukee, and then the next day was traded from Milwaukee. Literally the next day. It's kind of like that, which is funny.
And then I was also thinking that morning, literally Tuesday morning, I was like, because I was planning on retiring at the end of this year anyways, like. Very, very, very high probability, like 90%. And I was thinking that morning, it's so cool that I've never been dropped before and I get to finish my career not being dropped.
No shot.
Yeah, I'm dead serious.
That is so
true. I'm dead serious. And then also, I was kind of annoyed that morning too, because Vin always loves to do this. Not during teammate droppings, but just in general. Mm. He loves calling meetings really late at night, an hour before the next day's scrims. Mm. So, like, it was 11 p.m. that Monday night, and they were, like, team meeting on this Tuesday. And, like, Tuesday at 10 a.m. So I was already annoyed. I was like, what am I having to wake up at 10 a.m. for? Apparently it's to get dropped. Which was a little rude. I mean, making me wake up that early.
Right, you should have just had
dropped.
The talk last night.
Exactly. Like,
yeah, that's troll.
Honestly, now that you're saying that
that's
makes
ridiculous.
A lot of sense.
That's ridiculous, yeah. Right? Because now you could have slept in, you know, or you could like start drinking. Like, you know, it's like it's more socially acceptable to be like, ah, screw this, I'm getting drunk like at night. That's
you just
messed
made
up.
You made a point that I somehow never thought of. And those guys are awful.
Yeah, terrible humans. Yeah, let's send out some petty tweets about that. Actually, I think that sounds like the right move now.
Yeah, I think I've already done that enough for both of us. Okay, I did want it to last the whole weekend, the pettiness and like the roasting the Ravens, but I felt so bad after that one weekend that I was like, all right, we should stop. I've had my fun and I genuinely felt bad for roasting them so hard. But also, it was really funny that they happened to play the Warriors, which were, like, the best team.
Yeah.
So, like, obviously, I don't know if you guys saw my tweet, but, like, I was saying, basically, if I was playing, we would have got 3-0'd anyways. Mm-hmm. Probably not as bad, I mean,
yeah.
But it still would have been pretty bad. Yeah, basically, our fire giants weren't that great. And me and Vin have always wanted a vocal frontline and a controlling frontline setting up plays.
Mm-hmm.
And right now, we didn't have that. So then it came back to the backline being the ones to set up the plays. And me and Vin, on this team, I didn't feel like I could, on this team, be that vocal shot caller that they needed. Just because of some of the players on the team, I don't think I would be that open to shot calling and having that control. Mm-hmm. So then it made sense for them to basically drop one of the backliners to get a more vocal backliner. And there isn't really a mid outside of, like, Pagon, I think, that's vocal and controlling.
Yep.
So then it's like, Zap's a free agent, let's just get Zap. And I think it will make them better towards Worlds, but I think they're... Just from scrims, everyone's just making individual mistakes, and everyone's making cohesion or, like, teamwork mistakes as well.
Mm-hmm.
Which, in my opinion, when you have that many mistakes going on, it makes sense to make a change, because it's just kind of like a fresh slate. Something we can just start fresh, everything's, like, disappeared, all of our problems have, like, disappeared, so now we can kind of go through a honeymoon phase and kind of, like, reestablish our ground, so it makes sense to make a change.
Right.
Obviously, it sucks that I'm the guy that got dropped for it, but I don't really blame them, because scrims, like I said, since we've been back, have not been great. The environment was really bad. Our play was really bad. Just kind of everything was really bad. People weren't really, like, listening to each other and really talking. It was just a lot of, like, unhappy behavior.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it makes sense. Hopefully, as time goes on, they get better. But, yeah, I've had my my pettiness and my fun, so I truly am rooting for them now, but that Friday I was surely not. But after that Friday, I am now.
Yeah, as you are allowed to not root for them.
Thank you.
On that Friday, for the record.
Yeah, some people got, like, genuinely irked that I was, like, tweeting.
Yeah, they can genuinely sug my...
And I was like, you guys are just being, like, I don't know if parasocial is the right word, but it's just kind of like I'm, like, the golden child of Smite, I guess. Mm-hmm. So it's like, how dare he tweet these things that are just, like...
not allowed. Not allowed.
Rude to his teammates or something. Or ex-teammates.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I have some thoughts. I have not commented on this change at all publicly, and I've been thinking about it over time. I did not watch your interview with Hazer because I figured I was going to be talking to you. Well, no, I didn't, I said. I did not watch it.
Oh, okay. I said thank you.
Oh, then you're welcome. But I did watch Ven and Scream's interview with Hazer. And
so you just hate me.
Yes. Okay. I'm going to come at this. I'm going to have two separate takes here. One, as my boy Barra, who I've been doing a podcast with for a long time and who I'm friends with, got dropped. And then one as pretending I don't know anyone involved. And what is my thought there? And I'm going to start with the latter. So, not taking any of our relationship into account. You know me, I am pro roster change more often than not. I think you got unlucky, and this happens a lot in every sport, in that you just happen to play the role that the best free agent plays. And so that just puts more pressure on you. That being said, I agree with what you were saying, what you said, and what Ven was saying on his interview with Hazer, in that there needed to be some more backline driven comms, team direction, all that kind of stuff. That is not what I think of when I think of Zap. Zap is the best winner that Smite has ever had, right? He's won the most Smite World Championships, and that's not luck. It's not coincidence. But for his three World Championships, was he the best backliner on any of those three teams? Because the answer is strictly no. He had Paul, and Shinto. And that's not a bad thing. backlines are like batteries, right? Where you need a positive and a negative. Like, you need someone who can absorb pressure and do their job, and then you need someone who can play more selfishly and do the more, like, more highlight plays. Makes it sound like the other person isn't capable of that, and that's not really true. It really is like an ego thing, at least in my opinion. Backline is an inherently selfish. It's roles that attract selfish players, but it doesn't usually work when two players are both selfish or two players are both unselfish. And I think that was the case for you and Ven, was that you are both unselfish backliners by nature, and you want a selfish backliner to come in and be in there. Mm-hmm. Zap's greatest strength is that he can be a leader and an unselfish backliner at the same time. He can do his job, get insta-killed in every fight, and let his mid laner carry and not have it affect his mental or his shot calling or his confidence. And that is a legitimate strength that very, very few players have. So in that sense, I don't know that this solves the problem for the Ravens, because they've traded out an unselfish backliner for an unselfish backliner. Zap, historically, early in his career, he was a selfish backliner, and maybe the plan is to get him back into that space. But I don't see why that's necessarily more effective than, you know, trying to have you or Ven become more selfish. And I know that you and I, behind the scenes, have talked about you both trying to become more selfish players. But that is much easier said than done. Go ahead.
To interrupt you quickly, yeah. I had talked with Ven. I mean, I can just kind of like spiel it now. I've talked with Ven on and off several times about him being the selfish backliner and me kind of baiting myself in a lot of situations, which is the playstyle that I strived for as basically my, I don't say that my career was ending, but like towards the end, like the last like 2 years, I've never wanted to be the selfish backliner. I've always pushed Ven to be the selfish backliner, especially when mid is, in my opinion, very OP and has been very OP for the last like 2 years. I think having a more selfish person in mid makes more sense than having a more selfish person in ADC.
Mm-hmm.
So I think with Zap, as long as they, Ven just needs to like get out of that, I need to make a play right now and let the play come to him. Mm-hmm. I think if he's able to do that, because a lot of times he'll just like overthink or rush to things, and you kind of need to just kind of like enter in that like flow state, you know, of just kind of seeing the play in front of you and just going for it. When you know it's like a good play. But I do think Ven can get there. He just needs to, I don't want to say like believe in himself, but kind of like trust himself to make that transition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's possible that he will. And Zap has played with the best mid laner to ever live, who is Paul, and Shinto, who is an unbelievably great player in that play style as well. So he can potentially facilitate that and help Ven along that journey. But that's the big thing for me, is that they talk about wanting, in that interview with Hazer, he and Scream are talking about wanting to change their overall like team identity and how their team framework works. And it isn't, Zap incoming is not going to be as impactful in that way as I think that they would like him to be. And that it's going to take work from the rest of that team at the same time. So, you know, we will see. I think, like I said, I'm generally pro roster change for teams that have stagnated a little bit. It sounds to me like things were stagnating. It is, like I said, unfortunate for you that the most available, you know, the easiest free agent to pick up just happened to be in your role. But you know, it is what it is. Now from the other perspective, oh no, sorry, go ahead. Yeah. You should go first here.
I was just going to say, I think it will just, the addition of Zap will make them probably four some more things duo side, and then also probably 50-50 more fire giants, because I'm the kind of player that might have like PTSD from 50-50 fire giants, but that is like
you got Brooks Maddied too many times.
Yeah, that is my least favorite play of like you play Smite for 30 minutes and then you just walk to an objective and just 50-50 it. I don't think there's any play in Smite that I hate more than that specific play. And I think that having Steve on the team will kind of force them into doing those plays and getting out of their comfort zones, because I don't think a lot of them like that play either.
Mm-hmm.
But that play will definitely win you games, but also will definitely lose you games. So hopefully those 50-50 coin flips. Also, for whatever reason, we have been insanely unlucky with 50-50s on everything.
Well, maybe like, it's your curse, and getting rid of you is the way to remedy that in their
well,
minds.
Based off of the fire giants that I saw and the gold fears that I saw that still got stolen this weekend, I was like, yeah, they're still cursed. It wasn't me.
Well, listen, your aura is still there. You know, it has to linger for a little bit. You know,
My curse is still infecting them.
Right.
Yeah, I've always hated that play, so hopefully it'll work out for them. And then also, the front line just needs to come together and be cohesive around objectives.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times they'll have like conflicting calls, which I think is what they got Zap for, to just kind of mute all of the front line calls and just have that one person, like a dictatorship basically, to call everything so everyone listens to him.
Uh-huh.
Which I think in a honeymoon phase will work, but I think the attitudes on that team won't make it last longer than a honeymoon phase.
Sure. Yeah, I think that makes sense to me. I mean, that's the thing I was going to say about, you know, coming back to reality and, you know, it's my boy who's getting dropped and all that kind of stuff. Like, I do think that it is a little troll to have your really strong, the two strongest personalities on this team are Scream and Haddix, right? At least from the outside, that's my interpretation and from knowing those guys. Steve is not nearly as strong of a personality as he used to be, but it sounds like they want him to be a strong personality on that team. They're going to ask that of him. And I'm just not sure that adding another strong personality makes any sense to me, you know? Like, if you're talking about frontline cohesion, and I think that it's obvious in watching the Ravens play throughout this entire year that has been something that, and that's not an exclusive Ravens problem. It's one of the hardest things in the entire game to do. But clearly that was something that needed to do it. And it's not like, it's not StarCraft. Zap's not controlling everyone from the top down. In fact, it's really hard for him to control the front line from the back line. And the back line play is so predicated on front line play. And that's not to say that backliners are never to blame, or that, you know, Hurry, Scream, Haddix are the issue with the Ravens. That's not what I'm saying at all.
Mm-hmm. That's not what I'm saying either, to be fair.
Yeah, yeah. Like,
a lot of people are like, yeah.
Right.
Twist my words.
It's just like the thing coming in to this year on this team, and I'm pretty sure you can go back to the beginning of the year podcast and hear my thoughts are Haddix is known to be very vocal and opinionated on how he wants to play the game. Scream is maybe the most well-known opinionated team leader alongside like Genetics. He and Genetics are the most team warping typically. How those two mesh is going to be critical for this team's success is I'm pretty sure nearly exactly what I said at the beginning of this year.
Mm-hmm.
And that remains true now, in my opinion. And I just think there is, I have yet to be convinced that until that resolves itself, whether those two work together very well or one of them takes a backseat to the other, or, and maybe they already have, you know, this is about internal team dynamics that obviously I don't really know. But that is still the biggest clash, that has yet to pan out in my mind So we'll see. You know, I think it'll be interesting. I think it is, like when, like you were saying, like you were so close to being able to finish your career without, without getting dropped. And some, I saw some comment like, oh, I can't, you know, I saw some tweet like, oh, I can't believe Bear is being so petty or something like that. And I'm like, well, to be fair, like, when has he had a chance to be petty before this?
Exactly.
You've never given him the chance. You know what I mean? Like, maybe Barrett could have been petty for years if he had simply been getting dropped. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think it's because I always make, like, those jokes on stream. They're like, oh, it's Barrett. He's so cute. He's so funny. Look at him making jokes at other people's expenses. And, like, that's still what I'm doing over Twitter. But still, because it's over text, I think it comes off as, like, the... so aggressive, like the there's so much animosity behind what I'm typing, but
right
in reality I'm just making fun of them because they dropped me, and I feel like that is my duty as the droppee to make fun of them and strike back. I did it for a day, it was really funny, and then I felt bad at the end of the day and I was like, I should probably apologize.
You could have made a dark Barra Twitter account and gone for the rest of time as far as I'm concerned. Like, yeah, you could still like the, do it now.
The Medios' ego or whatever for all the league fans out there.
Yeah, that would be great. I'm all about it.
That was such a good Twitter account for back when Medios was playing.
Yep.
I agree with you. I don't think it'll fix their problems. I think it just kind of puts a Band-Aid to Worlds on their problem. On their problems. Yeah. And just hopefully it'll iron out. But I think... if that team is to win Worlds, I think Scream needs to get back to the kind of top form hyper carry jungler that he's known for.
Yep.
And just the, I'm running it early game, I'm controlling the entire map, and no one can basically stop me. And
right.
Same for everyone on that team. I feel like we weren't at top form across the board, including myself, since we've been back. I think our entire spring was really good. I mean, yeah, we lost to Hounds at the tournament, but I think our drafting going into that was just bad because we had like one or two strategies that we were really relying on in drafts, and then
bro,
they
who
out
is
in the
chat
top 30.
Gonna blame on the bad drafts on your team on? That's always been your fault.
I think it'll still be my fault. I think hopefully someone in the Reddit comments will still blame me for the bad drafts.
Yeah.
Just like my curse on
I'll get on my
50s.
Reddit smurf and do that.
The dark aggro Reddit
dark
account.
Aggro. That's just aggro, actually.
That's aggression. Sorry.
Yeah, I don't have a light... I need to have a light aggro Twitter account, to be honest, because most of the time I'm just in my dark... no one understands FaZe, you know? Like, it's just hard. That's all.
Yeah, you just didn't grow out of it, FaZe, you know?
It's not a phase, man. It's not a phase. That's the thing you gotta realize.
You have Hawthorne Heights listening or playing in your head, sir.
Bro, I've got a banging emo playlist. Hold on, let me pull it up. Hopefully this doesn't do it on stream. Okay, nice. I made Shane, the effects artist who came on a couple episodes ago, he was like, what type of music did you listen to in high school? Because he's like very young and makes fun of me for being old all the time, which definitely does not sit in my head rent free. And I was like, oh, you know, a lot of like emo bands, like Taking Back Sunday, Brand New, Dashboard Confessional, like all that kind of stuff. And he didn't know like any of them because he's an uncultured swine. And
that's embarrassing.
I was like, oh, I can make you a playlist if you want. And you can make a playlist for me of the things that like you listen to because I'm a big playlist guy.
Oh, that's cute. You guys are burning CDs for each other.
I burned so many CDs for people in high school. I guarantee you triple digits CDs burned by me. I was a CD king. I loved it. He was like, yeah, that sounds good. His playlist, hold on, let me find exactly how long it is. I still have it here. Let's see. Where is it? Okay, this is going to be really good podcast content if this takes me a while to find. And it probably will take me too long. So I'm just going... Oh,
don't worry,
is.
I'm just sitting over found here it. Sweating. Okay.
52 songs, 2.5 hours long. Very respectable playlist size.
Yeah.
My playlist size, which I limited to only bands that I listened to in high school, not including college, my favorite songs from those bands, and limited to only albums that were out while I was in high school. So nothing newer than 2010 when I graduated. Mine is 18 hours and 17 minutes long, 293 songs of pure emo bangers. And it is a fire playlist, for the record. I'm going to post this in our Discord. Are you kidding me? I'm going to post this in our Discord, patreon.com/backliners, if you want to get the link. It is heat from top to bottom. So, yeah, you can check that out in our community Discord if you so choose. I forget how we got there. Anyways, one last thing on this topic before we move on to the much more important topic, me and my work.
The bigger dropping
right
here.
the more important stuff. Did you you said you were planning on retiring probably at the end of the year? Like, was there any thought on, like, do I want to try and see if I can get a spot or coach or, you know, do any of those things? Or were you instantly like, yeah, okay, well, whatever, I'm out of here?
It was kind of just job availability at the end of the year. If basically what happened was I got dropped and they were also hiring at the same time. So I basically like dropped out of this boat and then swam like a foot and then jumped into this boat. So basically it was just if that happened to line up with January Worlds and everything, if I could swim boat to boat very easily. If not, I would probably go for coaching and just try to like build a team up from the bottom and just kind of try to make my mark in coaching, because I feel like I would be a good coach. Funnily enough, I feel like I would have a lot more input and a lot stronger of an opinion as a coach versus a player, because I feel like I could... This probably isn't true, but I feel like I could talk to people about their roles and gods in their role easier than as a player. Because sometimes when you talk to as a player, it's like, well, you have your problems too. Or like, you have your gods that you don't want to play too. And or like matchup wise, it always comes down to like almost like an argument or something versus a coach. Or you can just kind of just free flowing information.
I just can hear you being like, I want to criticize this person, but I wasn't very good at that as a player, so I don't feel like I can criticize.
Oh,
or like,
I would,
you know, like,
easily criticize.
Okay, all right. Do you think,
it would be so
like,
much easier.
Oh, okay, fair enough. Well, then maybe that could have been a great route for you. Oh, Sockfire is in chat. Shane, can you give a rating on our on the emo playlist I made you that was 18 hours long? Thank you.
That you surely listened to all of it.
Yeah, he definitely
remember
did.
All of it.
Yeah, he definitely did. Yeah, on the topic of the podcast and our plans moving forward, I think for now we're calling it up in the air.
Up in the air.
Yeah, BaRRa wants to see how things are going at the new job and all that kind of stuff and how much time he wants to invest at this moment. I can tell you that if BaRRa does decide he wants to step back, that I've been brainstorming some plans in that case. I am intending
and they have to get approved by me.
They do. I've got a spicy one for you, BaRRa, that I have not run by you yet for right after this podcast.
No.
Yeah, it'll be good. Okay, Shane says he did listen to most of it. Bayside was 10 out of 10. Good call. A few 9 and 8s. Average, though, probably 8 out of 10. For 18 hours, we take. For sure. But it's actually all 10 out of 10s. I've got some ideas. You know, obviously got to talk to the prediction guys as well, but there will be a Smite podcast remaining on, the prediction channel, moving forward, no matter what. But we're waiting to see how things kind of play out before we know for sure. Is kind of the way to
basically
do it.
I just want to see how much free time I have to watch SPL and keep up with Smite after it starts. Because I do really enjoy being on the podcast and talking with Agra about everything. But if I feel like extra stress from it or extra pressure to come home and like study Smite or... Because I on this past weekend, I really enjoyed watching SPL because I was detached from it. And it didn't feel like I it was like part of a job, basically, where you have to watch it and you have to study what's happening and see what teams are doing what and what you can do better as a team, because a lot of times people are like talking in Discord and everything during it. So it was nice to just like literally just sit back and watch and just relax. Probably similar to what you felt maybe when you stopped casting, or
it was a wild experience that I did enjoy a whole lot. I feel like I had a time where it became instantly very unenjoyable for me, because I just missed being a part of it. And the luster of not having to, you know, go through the parts of any job that no one likes going through, had, like, you know, you forget those complaints and that kind of stuff. And you're like, oh, wait, now I wish I was there, and I just don't. Watching it is just making me feel a little bummed out, so I definitely dropped off for a little bit. And I think I'm in a good zone now where I enjoy watching it, but I can't, as many of you can probably tell based on the podcast, I don't heavily prioritize it. Like before, when I first stopped, I would still like not make plans on weekends that I could watch. And then I was like, what is that? Like, what's the point of changing my work schedule if I'm still doing that? But yeah, there is something really fun about becoming a fan again. I will tell you that I guess it'll be different for you, because for players, there's no guarantee of what you're going to be doing at Worlds. You will have a blast at Worlds for sure, because it is so much more freeing for a player to not have to worry about their sets or coming off of disappointment of a set, you know, whatever it is. For me, Worlds is a ton of fun, and I look forward to it from like the day I recover from Worlds, which is like a week later, until it starts again. But yeah, the whole time I was like, damn, I really wish I was casting. Like, this would be so fun to cast.
Yeah, still haven't made my decision up whether I'm going
you will love bro, you can be drunk the whole time.
that's more than I'm drunk throughout the entire year.
Yes, exactly. It's great.
That's so much alcohol.
It's fine. Dude. You know? It's fine.
Okay, from last year with how sick I got, I think I might still be scarred from that.
Oh my God. We're going to put you in a bubble filled with alcohol. Like when SpongeBob wears the helmet in Sandy's, like, you know, terrarium that is filled with water. That's going to be you, but with, like, wine.
The thing that I need to stop doing is just accepting drinks from people.
Yes. Wait, you do that?
No.
Oh, Barry. Barry. Unless you see, like, I'm not saying that they're drugging you or something like that, but, like, you know.
I have thought about that every time, and thankfully I don't think I've ever been drugged. I went to a guy's trunk and drank alcohol out of it. What? I'm an overly trusting person.
Oh my God, Baron! I know. Maybe you shouldn't go to Worlds because you're just advertising to come in.
Yeah, Destiny's like typing about it in chat.
Kidnap you? What? What is that? Yeah, you got. If someone wants to buy you a drink, you can walk to the bar with them and stand there while the bartender makes it and talk with them during that time and a little bit afterwards, and that's all chill. And by the way, I will do that for you if you come to Worlds and offer to buy me a drink. I'll stand there and watch the bartender drink it and have a great time talking to you.
Yeah, a lot of times I'll just be talking to people, and then they're like, oh, Bear, I got you a drink. Here you go.
Nope.
You're telling me I can just turn that down?
Yep.
But they have two drinks. What are they supposed to do with the drink?
That sounds like a them problem, bro. Here, you don't have to be like, no, that's weird. You just go, oh, no, I'm too drunk already. I can't. Or like, I've got someone bringing me a drink right now. There's a million little lies.
You want me to lie to them?
Yes, I want you to lie to them. Lying is not inherently bad in that situation, man. I'm telling you. Lying can be good, okay? And that is a good example of that.
Like, okay, I'll work on my lying for then.
We can work on that for sure.
Okay, good.
Yeah, that
maybe the drunk booze had a role to play.
Bro.
Yeah, I thought about it when I was going out there, then I was like, I lost. It doesn't matter. If I die, I die. You know?
Well, I mean, as long as you were aware of it, then that's fine.
Yeah, yeah. The post-world sadness of, you know, losing and then, you know, getting offered a drink out of a trunk, you know, it's you got to accept it. You know, that's
well, that's the thing is that you won't have the pain of losing this time.
thank you.
You'll just be winning the whole time because you'll be true. You'll be drunk. Come to Worlds. This is going to be your favorite Worlds, like, ever, if you go. I'm telling you.
It might be my saddest Worlds as well, though.
Well, I don't know. You were pretty sad that one year. What year was that?
Every year.
Right.
Well, the last nine, or the last eight, actually.
I feel like I saw you the most sad after season 3 Worlds.
That was a killer. Yeah.
You were pretty sad after that one.
Yeah.
Understandably so. Sure. Okay, before we move on to Maman, I've got something that will make you less sad, and it's not having to cook stupid lunch. Here's a lie.
Stupid lunch.
Here's a lie for you to start off this ad read. Cooking is not inconvenient. That's a lie. It is inconvenient. Cleaning up is not omega cringe. That's a lie. It is omega cringe. Factor did not write any of these. That is not a lie. They did not write any of those. But here's what they did write. With the busy fall season already in swing, you might be looking for wholesome, convenient meals for jam-packed days. Factor, America's number one ready-to-eat meal kit, can help you fuel up fast with chef-prepared, dietitian-approved, ready-to-eat meals delivered straight to your door. You'll save time, eat well, and stay on track with your healthy lifestyle. Maybe you just got dropped from the Ravens for the 3rd time, and you're going to be starting a new job soon. Worried about what you're going to do for lunch? Wow, this is really personalized. If you're worried about what you can do for lunch, Factor's perfect for you. You can get some easy meals that are ready in just 2 minutes. You can have vegan meals that are delicious.
That's me.
And they'll make you feel better, especially if you go to Worlds and party with all your friends. Well, actually, Factor knows right there.
This is just directed at me, I think.
Yeah. Hey, John Salter. Oh, my
Thank
God.
You, Factor.
What is this? No, wait. I was reading over this and I was like, dang, that's actually sick. No, it wasn't that. Well, it was that, but... Have I told you all about the upscale meals with premium ingredients like broccolini, leeks, truffle butter, and asparagus? Have I told you about that?
I don't think so.
I don't think I've told you about that. Premium ingredients. So make sure you keep that in mind. Plus, you get some easy lunch-to-go options with effortless, wholesome meals like grain bowls and salad toppers that are ready to eat when you're on the go. No microwave required. If you thought microwaving was too much of a hassle, somehow, then they've even got something for you there, which is absolutely crazy. Here it was. With Factor, I read this and I was stoked about it. With Factor, you can also rest assured that you're making a sustainable choice. They Ooh. Offset 100% of their delivery emissions, source 100% renewable electricity for their production sites and offices, and feature sustainably sourced seafood in their meals. So, what's to complain about? Nothing, if you ask me. This September, get Factor and enjoy eating well without the hassle. Simply choose your meals and enjoy fresh, flavor-packed meals delivered to your door. Ready in just 2 minutes. No prep, no mess. Head to factormeals.com/backliners50 and use code backliners50 to get 50% off. That's code backliners50 at factormeals.com/backliners50 to get 50% off. Thanks to Factor for sponsoring today's episode. Okay.
Woohoo!
Barry,
hello. Oh.
We've got...
Attached to that Factor ad.
Yeah.
I was doing a Factor sponsorship for my stream the last, like, 2 weeks, and I got my box this Monday.
Uh-huh.
And with me and Destiny being very sick this whole week,
uh-huh.
the Factor meals came in clutch. I will say, it was very nice to just walk to my fridge, pop it in the microwave for 2 minutes, and have a healthy meal that tastes really good.
Yep.
So I was really enjoying that. Sorry, continue.
Yeah, no, it's big time. It's the best. Okay, this was supposed to be a really big, fun episode because I get to talk about the god that I've been working on for months and months and months.
Mm-hmm.
Maman Brigitte has been revealed and now released into Smite. I think it is all... I always get really excited whenever these gods get actually revealed because I've been like thinking about these things for months, and then I just like can't share it with anyone, which stinks. But yeah, I don't know. I don't think we, and especially with the time that we have remaining and all that kind of stuff, I don't want to go like ability by ability necessarily, but maybe we could, maybe we could do a little bit. Bear's like,
I got nowhere else to be. I'm unemployed.
Oh, true. Right. Okay. Yeah. Great. No, I think, the thing that I wanted to talk about the most, was something that I was really excited about. And that's, I pushed very heavily for the entirety of her development, for this passive oriented playstyle. Well, not that you play passively, but the kit is centered around.
I would know something about playing passively.
You sure would, Jingwei. But in this instance, you aren't playing Jingwei. You're playing Maman. And I really wanted to see how far we could push the abilities are just catalysts for the passive, and the passive is the thing you care about the most type gameplay. In my wildest dreams, like, it would be like you take 70 of the 100% of the damage you take from Maman, 75% would be from the passive and 15% from the abilities. That doesn't really work in practicality. I think right now it's like 60% ability damage, 40% passive damage, roughly. And that is significantly higher than most gods in the game. And I'm really happy with the way that she turned out. I was definitely very worried about how the community reception would be on something like that, because it is asking players to engage in a kit a little bit differently than they have for the 127 ahead of her, or whatever that number is. I thought that players would be like, oh, she just stinks, or oh, this like is super overpowered. And there are certainly a lot of people saying that she's very strong, and she could turn out to be, our sample size is a little bit too small right now, but she's not like one of the best gods ever released type strength, which is really good, because I was a little bit concerned about that for a little bit, but did some nerfs beforehand, and I think that helped a lot. And yeah, I've been very happy with the reception on that, the difference in kit direction, because I think that is something that really interests me in MOBA design, is pushing boundaries and asking players to think differently based on the character they're playing. I'm very pleased with people being open to that type of direction for her.
Is she just a jungler, or yes. Is she okay?
Yeah, I don't think she can lane very well at all. She has very low range. She doesn't. Her passive is such an important part of her damage, and it's all scaling. There's no base damage to it at all. So you can probably get away, like, you know, I did a lot of splashing of Magi's and that kind of stuff. But if you go two defense items, your damage is like pretty tanked. And her damages across the kit are very, very low.
Yeah, that's what I've been seeing
in comparison to other damage characters, but that's because she's getting so much of the heavy lifting from the passive. So, yeah, I think I'm super stoked with how her reception has been, for sure. A lot of complaints around the three. We knew that was going to be the case. But I do think that there is more counterplay that just takes time to understand. It's a character that is hard to use your Aegis against, but not impossible. You just need to Aegis at different timings for her, which takes a little bit of adjustment.
What ability are you Aegising, or are you looking to Aegis? What do you say?
Yeah, you have to Aegis when Aegising the dash ticks is more important than the dash initial damage. You want to force her to commit to stay to possessing you for as long as possible, because her passive is based on missing HP. So her early damage, like,
oh, gotcha, yeah, yeah.
Her initial engage doesn't do a whole lot, and a lot of times you want to Aegis like a character's initial burst, because once you get low, then your margin for error is smaller, but your margin for error against her is actually bigger early than it is late. So you actually want to Aegis later against her than you would against most characters. And while the dash is undeniably extremely powerful, it is a heavy commitment. And gods like Artemis, Ardeo, Nox, Poseidon do extremely well into her. Here's a little tip. When she exits from the target, she has to exit from them first. And that seems like kind of a troll thing to say, but what I mean is, if you put an Artemis trap on your feet and then just stand on it when she's possessing you, it will trap her when she comes out. So putting her in bad spots like that is definitely doable for more characters than it seems like initially, but it was my intent for her to be very good late game. I think right now her early game is probably a little bit too good for how good her late game is, but I also think that the question I found myself asking a lot to playtesters when they would say, oh man, I just got like two tapped by her late game, is, would you have died to Hebo that fast or that easily, or even easier to Hebo if he had that many items at that point in the game? In most circumstances, she's not killing people faster than Hebo would in a similar circumstance. And Hebo is really good at killing people, don't get me wrong. But that is, I think Hebo is a closer comparison than like Alquang. Because Alquang's kit just like kind of flows differently. She is like a murderer, like Hebo. Like Hebo just murders. Alquang like does, his, you know, he murders, but it's like in a different way. Like this is blunt force. Like I just numbers you in the late
barrel
game.
Stuffed.
Yeah, exactly. And she does numbers you in the late game for sure. I'm not trying to say, you know, that she won't be getting nerfed or that she is getting nerfed or anything like that. But the intent direction for now, and intent does change as gods are in the wild, intent is that I do want her late game to be strong, and I want her early game to reflect that late game strength, which means that she probably needs to be a little bit more vulnerable there. In my personal opinion, we haven't made a call yet on if we are nerfing her.
Kind of like the OG Kali, where if you get her to late game, she'll just kind of win the game for you sometimes. That kind of character?
No, I mean, I don't want it to be binary. Okay. It is crazy to me that, like, in League of Legends, it really is that binary. Where it's like, oh, they're Vladimir, they're Master Yi, whatever. They're Kassadin. They hit 16, they're Kayle. We lose. We lost our interaction point. I think that is insane that is, like, accepted. I never want it to be binary like that, but I do think that something that, in my opinion, we could do more of is accentuate strengths at the cost of their weaknesses. Like, allow characters to be better at the things they're good at and weaker at the things they're bad at. And I think the Arachne change that we talked about a few weeks ago is a good example of that, where we make Arachne even better the thing she's good at, to the point where if she gets in her good spots, then she feels really, really strong. But we don't necessarily help her in her weak areas, and that is the intentional position for her. That
makes sense.
That's my personal preference.
I haven't seen her, so are like her early game ganks just really strong, or does she just win like the mid 2v2s really strong, or just kind of everything?
I think her clear is probably a little bit too good.
Okay.
I think her fight is pretty not is okay, but not great. It really is so centered around the passive, and because it's scaling based, you just don't have the power to be threatening early. But you know, late, she does some messed up stuff to people late for sure. But I think that assassins are one of the hardest classes to gauge strength of early, because people will just die to things they shouldn't die to. People will just die to things that they won't die to next week when they play against her for the
It's the same with
time.
Arachne stun buff, in my opinion, where like it took me like 10 times to get stunned by it, and then after that I was starting to beat it.
Yeah.
And then it just, it's that adjustment period of, oh my gosh, I actually died to that, and then you're like, okay, I'm expecting the damage or expecting that.
Right.
Well, obviously, I haven't played her, so I don't know if she's, like, genuinely overtuned or just kind of, like, surprise overtuned, you know, like, the fake overtuned.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And it's really too early for data to be able to tell us that either. But her... I was surprised at her day one stats. She was 43rd in god damage among players over 2k MMR. And... that was my biggest concern, was that she would just do too much damage. And 43rd is a really good spot for her to be in on that first day. But she'll also, it's, you know, it's, there's two sides of the coin. She'll get worse because people will learn how to play against her, but players will also get better at playing her. And she does, I think she is one of the harder characters to execute on perfectly, right away. I think a clear thing that I want to work on for my future god design is, I think all three of my gods have been too hard for the average player to get the most out of them. And that's something that I want to... Making it easier doesn't mean making it less interesting. But
just the floor higher.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And
that makes sense.
I think... we got there more so on her than I was worried about for a little bit. Chaos kind of came in big with that. Basically, the way her one works, her one is a Pele fuel style ability where you can turn it on and turn it off. And it's basically like a cone that is a cuckoo tornado. So it's just a dot applicator in that area. But her fuel doesn't regen. It's just... whenever it reaches zero, then she slams her rum bottle and stuns people around her. And then it goes on cooldown, and then when it comes off cooldown, she has 100 fuel. My initial design was that she actually couldn't reactivate the stun early at all. That you had to manage your fuel properly in order to get your stun off. And that ended up definitely not feeling right, feeling too hard. Too punishing if you didn't engage in the loop. And for a late game assassin, like, okay, I got my first stun off, and then I have to, what, channel for 2 seconds to get my later stun? Like, that'd be terrible.
Yeah.
And then it swapped to, okay, you can reactivate to slam, and we have two cooldowns. One that is short if you run out of fuel and slam, and one that is long if you slam early at all. But that also felt really punishing, because it's like, oh, I had 10 fuel left and I slammed and I've got a 15 second cooldown instead of a 6 second cooldown, whatever. And Chaos the Goat was like, what if we just made it so that there was the base cooldown and then a second cooldown number that was that changed linearly based on how much fuel she had left. And I was like, holy crap, you're a freaking genius. So that's the way it works. It's 6 second base cooldown and then 8 seconds based on how much fuel you have remaining. So if you have 50% fuel remaining when you slam, then you take half of 8, which is 4. So it's a 10 second cooldown. If you run all the way to 0, it's 0 out of 8. So 0, 6 seconds. You can't slam at 100 because there's some tick time, but you can have like up to a like 13 and a half second cooldown type of thing. So... I think that ended up making it feel It's exactly, it's better. Yeah, it's better than I could have ever hoped in terms of if you engage with the loop, we still get that reward. You still get the lower cooldown. It still feels unique and fun to me. And if you don't, then you still have all of your options, but you are punished, quote unquote, according to how much you engaged with the loop, which I think, mm-hmm. which I think turned out like super, super well.
Nice. Yeah. I feel like I would be very bad at God design. Just hearing you talk about all of that, I feel like I would just have the initial idea and throw it out there and be like, there's my God. I finished.
Yeah. Well, you learn quickly. I thought that's how I would be too. And then like Maui, for example, like he was dog. He was so bad. And I was like, oh my God, my God doesn't work. Like, this doesn't work. It's bad. It doesn't function. It doesn't feel right. And there's been a significant pivot like that on at least one ability on every god I've worked on. And that probably says something about my skills as an initial designer. But it's also like that's just how it is. And it's part of the process and why you have a team who's working on it. Because it's just so important. Yeah, you just need someone to... When you're just like thinking about a god 24/7 for like months, and then you can recognize there's a problem, but you're too close to being able to see how to fix that problem. And outside perspectives make a huge, huge difference for sure. Like her two initially was just Cirquette one, but as a projectile, it was just like three lines. And it just did not feel right. It just didn't feel great. Like, I don't know. It just felt.
What is that ability? I don't think I've seen anyone use. I've seen people use all three of the other abilities, but I don't know if I've seen the two.
It's a snake projectile.
Okay.
And
is it just a line targeter?
No,
line targeter.
It is okay. Instead of three. Think of Cirquette, but instead of three lines making up the zigzag, it's five. So it's shorter. They're shorter lines.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And there's also a minimum range, so you can't like squish it all the way flat like you can with Cirquette. But that overnight transformed the ability into feeling like thematic and good and unique. That felt really cool. Although here's a really quick funny story about the two. On one of her initial concept, one of her initial final concepts, the snake on her arm was purple. The snake tattoo on her arm was purple, and I wrote the voice pack, and you know, we have to write the ability lines for what they say when they use an ability. And, I love naming things. That's a thing I like to do. So I was like, you know, a lot of French Creole, background. It'll be, violette, you know, like violet, the snake, 'cause it's like purple. It's great. It's cute. It's thematic. Huge win. The day before we record the voice pack, I look at her in game and I'm like, wait, what the heck? The snake is green. When did that happen? And I was like, oh no, I can't have a snake, a green snake named Violette. That doesn't make any sense. Like, what am I going to do? And so I had like a literal brainstorming session on names for the snake. I was kind of trolling when I threw out like Madame Fangs as a name, or Madame Fangs. People were like, yeah, it's like, who cares? You know, she's like kind of a fun god, like not taking herself super seriously, all that kind of stuff. And then when I was naming I like instantly fell in love with it. We got to change it in time for the voice back recording, all that kind of stuff. And it led to, I didn't have a name for the mark that the two applied, and I needed to find a name for that. And Madam's mark is just like, so was so sick, so easy, so instant. And Madam Fangs, I think, is a really funny troll name. And then when I was naming the abilities, I was like, clumsy, I'm naming this ability Madam Fangs, and you can't stop me, but actually you can, just tell me if you really don't like it, but I really want to name this ability Madam Fangs, because I think it's really funny. And it is
a funny name.
Thank you.
Well, it's a cute name.
Yeah. It's like a little goofy.
Yeah, just something you name like an adorable pet snake.
Yeah, exactly. And so you haven't like seen it. If you haven't played her yet, and probably most people who haven't, I mentioned on the patch notes show, when I was coming up with this ability, I was like, oh, it would be really cool if we could, you know, the theme of the ability is that the snake tattoo slithers off of her arm and does its projectile thing. Wouldn't it be really cool if we could make the tattoo disappear from her arm because it went away to go do the projectile, and then it comes back when it's back on off cooldown? And I was really stoked when we were able to get that in. So when you use the two, the snake tattoo like disappears from your arm, and then it slowly comes back as it comes off cooldown, and that like actually that's works cute. With like cooldown reduction and all that kind of stuff.
Well, that's adorable. I do like the name of the third ability, the Spirit Seeds ability.
Yeah. Yeah, Spirit Seeds big time.
I saw a few clips of people like riding Chernabogs already, and I think one of like riding a Surtur.
Yeah.
And I feel like that's just a really cool interaction. Because obviously, like, you don't see that many of it with Noxus, but I feel like if you're the aggressor, I feel like it's so much easier to do that play.
Yep.
So I knew nothing about that god, and then I saw the plays of it, and I'm like, oh, that seems pretty sick. So I'm excited to see her in SPL and just kind of see the plays that people are able to make. But hopefully she's not, as Agro was saying earlier, like too hard countered by certain characters, so she does get SPL play. But I assume people will find the counter she were, or just have a little Umoja factor and just permaban.
No Umoja 2.0.
Of course not.
No Umoja 2.0. No. You know, I was thinking about this. It's kind of... My gods have not really dominated SPL very much. Like, obviously, Maui looked really good at Worlds.
Mm-hmm.
Then we nerfed him. Hasn't seen much play since then. Ishel has seen, like, next to no play. So, surely we need to buff that god. It's only fair that I get an SPL dominator, right? Like,
yeah.
That seems...
Sorry,
seems fair.
Someone in chat said BaRRaCCuDDa's retiring, and about the beginning of the podcast.
Yeah. Yeah. That's, well, Syphus, you can listen to the VOD to get some context. Is that a more brutal way to find out, is just clicking on the stream title? Like, wait, what? Like, Bear is retired.
I was gone for a week.
Yeah, like, what happened? That's so true. Clumsy designed Umoja is a question in chat. So yeah, that's Maman. Super stoked with how she turned out. Oh wait, one more really quick story about her that I wanted to tell on the podcast. I will say that with Maui and Ishel, their ultimates were the first ability I made. And I really was never worried about their ultimates like feeling cool or you know, epic or satisfying, anything like that. I had the passive and 1-3 of Maman done. And I was feeling really confident about those. And I could not come up with the ult for this kit for a long time. And it was really hard. Most for Ishel and for Maui, I really had to like work on it was not easy coming up with. For Maui, it was exactly what the two would be. For Ishel, it was what the three would be. And what the AO1A would be. I always knew I wanted the triangle as a secondary component, but I couldn't get that first part for a while. And those were really hard. But I think in having now had an ultimate be the struggle point, that felt a lot worse, because the ultimate is such a key part of like what makes a character feel satisfying and be memorable and all that kind of stuff. And man, I struggled with this ult a lot for a lot of its development. And initially, you know, it's obviously very Spirit Bomb-esque.
That's exactly what I was going to say.
Yeah. I mean, I called it Spirit Bomb. I had a gif of Spirit Bomb. Like, it's obviously a huge inspiration for it. And I wanted it to be that type of, when I think of Spirit Bomb, I think of it being absolutely huge and slow. And like this, like feeling of anticipation of like, oh, it's going to hit. And that was where this ultimate was for a long time, where it was, she would throw it and it would be really slow. And then she could like do all of these other things, all that kind of stuff. And then it would kind of boom and be, and it was way, way, way bigger. And it was not well liked, among the playtesters, and among the team, to go in that direction. But I just could not like conceive of how this would really fit with the kit. Like, and I didn't feel like it had, it fit super great beforehand, but at least it had its own like purpose. And yeah, for a long, and, you know, I was also playing with like, should she be raised out of combat for like the throw and the time, because I wanted you to be able to use your dash aggressively. And if you, if your ultimate doesn't give you some sort of survivability, then you can't ever really dash aggressively as an assassin, or as any damage dealer. So, you know, my initial kit flow thought was that she could dash into an enemy, dash out into the middle of the team, and then kind of like raise up with this big ball and like slam it down. And that would buy her some time to like get some help. But the three proved to be so strong in terms of its immunity. We really didn't want to give her another form of immunity. And the giant size of Spirit Bomb, the ultimate, because I know you haven't played, the ultimate grows in size. It has six different sizes that are based on how many times you've procced your passive on gods. It does the same damage no matter what, but it's just growing in size. The initial size was, I think, the smallest was as big as Maui Alt, so very big. I think that's like in between sizes 4 and 5, or 5 and 6 on its current one. And then it grew to be the biggest AoE in the game. And it was huge. And it
like
looked
bigger than Volcanoel?
Yeah.
And Opwash Alt?
Oh, yeah. Well, Opwash is like a square, or like a rectangle. Like biggest circle in the game. And I really wanted it to be this like, oh Lord, it's coming type of moment. You know, if she had like been able to stack that up, because it isn't easy to do. But it just was not really working. We made some really late changes to it, and got it feeling a lot better. And then the thing that made me feel a lot better about it was having it apply Madam's Mark on enemies hit. Instantly made it feel so much more cohesive with the kit. And that came in pretty late. And I feel really stupid that I didn't just have that like initially. Like, I don't know what I was thinking, but it was, you know, that's how it be sometimes.
Yeah, it just makes it flow better.
Yeah, for sure. It made a night and day difference. And now it ended up feeling, looking really, really awesome. Surprised that I haven't gotten any complaints yet. I'm sure I will now that I've said this, about it being a knockup. But it is the smallest, the lowest knockup in the game. It is lower than Shiva 2. Which was previously the lowest knockup in the game. So I was worried about adding a CC, but when it didn't have a CC, it felt not very epic, and didn't convey its weight very well, which is something I think about a lot.
Maybe if it's a giant ability, you should feel scared or intimidated by what's about to happen. And if you're not, then, you know, something, one of the knobs needs turning.
Exactly. Yeah, it's like you gotta be scared of for some reason. But yeah, I think overall I was more concerned about her release than I was. It was a different type of concern than I had with Maui, because with Maui I was like, I just don't know what I'm doing. With her, I was like, I know what I'm doing, and I'm scared that it isn't gonna turn out right.
I mean, magical assassins are so hard to balance. And especially, yes, it just changes drafts a lot if she's actually good.
Yep.
So, it, like, that god, if she's really good SPL level, completely changes the dynamic of mid-jungle drafting.
Yep. Did you see Blue's Ultra stats from, I think it was this last week, that mid lane, it was 30% assassins in mid this last week, which I think is sick. I think that's really cool. to see that class, like, or that role gain some diversity, not just in type, because, you know, physical hunters have been there forever, but in class. I think that's really awesome.
Yeah, it did feel like more than 30%. I think it was just because the people that were playing those gods, if they had a dominating game, it's like, wow.
Yep.
That looks rough.
That's that is what assassins tend to do.
Yeah. And I do think assassins are good right now, and then also laning in mid, as far as I know, isn't super important right now, as long as you're like controlling the mid camps and everything. And so if you have a stronger fight in mid, it makes sense.
Yep.
To draft like that.
I feel you on that. Okay, it's time almost for our random question of the week, but before we go to that, it's time to let you know that this show or episode of the Backliners is sponsored by BetterHelp. Barra and I have been very excited to work with BetterHelp because we are big proponents of going to therapy. I almost slept through my therapy this morning because my alarms didn't go off on my phone, but legitimately, not like when you're in high school and alarms didn't go off, or, you know, college, or like last week when alarms didn't go off, but they actually didn't. And I was like, oh crap, I'm going to miss my therapy appointment. And I was like, actually sad, because I was really looking forward to it this week. I have definitely found that it is critical for me feeling like I am at my best. It just kind of gets, it's like a cleanse, you know, it's like an emotional cleanse of, you're getting all the nasty out and working through your stuff. And then you're out the other side and you're feeling light as air. And that is ideal. If you ask me,
yeah, it's Barry, a lot of beans for your emotional state.
Yeah, well, but I don't like beans, you know, but I love therapy.
You don't love beans?
Beans are terrible, bro.
I love beans and I love therapy. I'm just a massive proponent of it. It changed my life completely. Just being able to talk to someone about the things that you don't really feel comfortable with talking with other people and getting a professional's opinion on, as Agra says, how your brain works and why your brain thinks the certain ways that it does to different stressors and to different stimuli, and just trying to either better understand your brain or better understand why you're reacting to different situations in a certain way. I think therapy is extremely beneficial. And then also BetterHelp, which is one of my favorite things about it. If you're not meshing with your therapist, you can easily swap to a different therapist and still just kind of stay on your same track. Obviously, you have to restart a little bit switching therapists, but if you're not meshing with that with your therapist, it's okay. Yep. You can still restart. You can still go on your therapy journey. And then also, if you're nervous about it, through BetterHelp, you can do text, or you can do phone calls, or you can do video. So whatever is on your comfort level. If you're just beginning and you just want to talk to someone about some stuff or just have a normal conversation, you can do that.
Yep. Great way to put it. So if you want to live a more empowered life, therapy can get you there. Visit BetterHelp.com/backliners today to get 10% off your first month. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/backliners. Big shout out to BetterHelp. Okay, let's go to our random question of the week. This is in our Patreon Discord, community Discord, which you can find by going to patreon.com/backliners. And there will shortly be a link to my esteemed emo playlist, which you will not which you will not want to miss. Okay, I can't remember if we answered this one. We do have a lot. We're going to have to rapid fire here a little bit.
The last was the parking garage thing. I remember that one.
Oh, man. Okay, yeah, we do have a lot. All right, then we're going to have to rapid fire here a little bit, Barry. How about that?
Easy peasy.
Okay. Odd Otters asks, inspired by the dumb bug people found in Destiny 2 today. That was crazy bug, by the way. Basically, you could make a gun shoot a different type of projectile or a different amount of projectiles and do like a billion damage. The fact that their engine could handle that is actually crazy. And they were just like, yeah, have fun. We got to leave it because we can't really fix it that fast. And it was just like a chaotic weekend of Destiny 2, which is really cool. But anyways, what are the best and worst bugs you've experienced in any game? Can be a matter of worst to figure out, most fun, weirdest interaction you didn't expect, etc.
Best bugs, I would say, would be... I think it was either Janice or Morgan, when you were just falling through the map. I can't remember which god it was. Maybe it was when you were de-transforming as Morgan. You would just fall through the map. Honestly, all the Morgan bugs over the years have been a lot of fun. On top of that, all of the Halo bugs in Halo 3, just with like the super bouncing and everything, and then in Halo 2, like double shotting and like BX being or like canceling your reload to melee again. I always thought the bugs that didn't break the game but made it more skillful were a lot of fun. Worst bugs, probably the Morgan bugs. As an SPL player, having that god be let through for tournaments and then just kind of like play at your own risk, and you're like, okay, so I would go with Morgan on both.
Yeah, that's fair. One of my favorites, the Baron skin bug with the big hat. Where if you canceled his like VXG at the right time, your hat would remain really big. I love that that is still in the game. And we have said we are not fixing it because it is just for you. And it's, you know, if you want to make your screen a little harder to see through with this, but it looks really funny, then go for it. I think that's really awesome. Definitely the hardest I've ever laughed, at a bug was the javelin glitch back in the MW2 days, where you would lock in with your javelin and then as you fired, you would hold your Semtex down and it would animation cancel it and you'd be locked to that animation until you were killed. And then, or if you let go of your Semtex, you would instantly blow up and explode. But it also happened if you were shot, and you would just run around and dare people to shoot you and then have this like massive explosion. It was so funny. Yeah, those are definitely the two that come to mind. There's also a really great, I think I might have tweeted it at some point. If I haven't, then I probably should, because I think I can. There was a time in Surtur's development when we were doing a 3v3, like one of his early playtests, and just playing a joust match, and we discovered that if someone used a relic, or maybe it was like used a shard, it was during like early shard testing, it would crash the game, and I'm like chasing AJ, who's on 1 HP, and then he intentionally like crashes the game so I don't get to kill him. And that was a very funny bug that that comes to mind. Okay, Spataz, do y'all have a bidet? And if not, why don't you like having the best poop of your life? We do have a bidet, and I do think they are the best thing ever. In fact, we go home to visit my mom a couple times a year in Pittsburgh, because that's where both of our families are. And we installed a bidet in her guest bathroom that we use when we're there because we hated not having it when we were there. They're the best. Barry, do you guys have a bidet?
Yes, and I completely agree with you. It's something you don't realize how good your life could be until you get one. You're like, wow, that is so much better. Why have I not been doing this my entire life?
It's true. Get one. They aren't expensive. They aren't hard to install. Do it. Your life will be better. We need a bidet sponsor. That's what we need. Hiru asks, what is something that you're supposed to like but personally find slightly or generally annoying? Something that I'm supposed to like. Like sports fans for sure. Especially when I was working in sports broadcasting, the people who just get like way too into the game, and are like yelling at the TV, not in like a, you know, go, like we get, you know, like, oh, that's awesome. You know, it's cheering for a big play, but like getting up and like screaming like, you moron, like, what are you thinking? Like, who needs that, you know? And especially for college sports, bro. Those guys are literal kids. Like, they are kids. And these adults are, like, screaming these horrible things. It drives me crazy. I do not like that at all. That's mine.
I think it's this Netflix show called I Think You Should Leave.
Okay, you're supposed to love it, Barry. How can you... Oh, this is the worst day of my life. Not really, but this that upset me greatly. I don't know, not see that coming. I don't know. M. Messi asks, how was your day? That's a nice
really
question.
Good.
Go ahead,
I am getting destroyed by my sickness. I was doing really good for the first 3/4 of this podcast, but last 4th, I have been so dizzy. And
Okay, we're going to speed up.
I've just been swimming around in my chair. I don't know if you guys have been noticing, but I'm just sweating.
Okay, I'm sorry, Barry. We're going to get you through it. Okay,
but overall, good. Overall, good.
My day was good. Yeah, I'm gonna. It was okay to good. I'm gonna put it there. Sea fog, light or dark mode? Dark mode,
dark.
Free. Yeah, it's dark. Don't
it's
toss me this
light mode
garbage.
Until I figure out how to change it to dark mode, and then once I change it to dark mode, it's dark mode forever.
Yep. M. Messi asks, any fun and or terrible memories from living in apartments? They just moved in a month ago, and they're already molding at their leasing office over crappy laundry machines.
Really loud neighbors would be my terrible memories of, I think it was the people directly next to us, would just yell and then have very passionate arguments afterwards.
Yep.
And it was a really enjoyable time. And then we also lived on the top floor.
Mm.
So walking up the stairs with groceries, that was also terrible. But the fun part was just kind of living on my own for the first time. And having to take care of everything yourself is just kind of like an eye-opening experience.
Sure is. That's for sure. Yeah, a lot of bad leasing offices. We had an apartment with one of those giant mirrors in the bathroom where like it's over an entire wall. And that mirror fell in the middle of the night and like shattered all over our floor. And that was not ideal. That was not my favorite thing about apartments, and having neighbors who like smoke cigarettes also sucks.
Yeah,
that just sucks. Yoma asks, if you cook, what dish are you most confident cooking, / what dish do you cook when you want to impress someone?
I would go with my seitan right now, which is just kind of wheat meat. It's basically just a meat substitute. I finally found a really good recipe that tastes a lot like meat, and you can substitute it in a lot of different recipes, so having non-vegan people eat that would be really fun for me. And just kind of like, it's literally my favorite snack right now, is just throwing barbecue sauce on it and just chowing down. And then also, because Destiny cooks a lot for us, so if she was cooking, I would say probably this lasagna that she made when I first went vegan. It's just like top tier, delicious.
Mm. Yeah, I think the thing that I cook the most that it's not an impressive recipe, it's just easy and tasty, is like beef bulgogi-esque like rice bowl type thing. It is so easy, I can literally tell you how to make it right now in like a minute. You just take some ground beef, or ground pork is actually better in my opinion for it, like a pound, put it in a bowl, dice up an onion, put it in the bowl, put 5 tablespoons of soy sauce, 3 tablespoons of mirin, and 3 tablespoons of sugar. Mix it all together, put it in a pan on the stove, cook it until there's like the meat is cooked through and the liquid is reduced by like half. Put that over rice before you take it off the heat, the last minute it's on there, good amount of MSG and sesame oil and scallions or green onion. Take it off, put it over some rice. That's it. More sesame seeds, the top, you know, the green part of the scallion. Let's go, it's Hamlet time.
Why are you trying to smack me?
Dude, this is a weird pose that he's hitting right now.
Put your arm down, you weirdo.
But yeah, that banks. It is very tasty. Hiru asks, what is something immature or childish that you can't stop doing?
I don't know. I'm a very mature person.
I guess mine would be biting my nails. I bite my fingernails, but I'm really good at it. So, like, is it that bad? You know, that's something to think about.
What is something immature or childish that I do that I should stop doing? This is scary to ask.
It just can't stop doing, not should stop doing. Because I will not stop biting my nails.
Can't stop
doing. I absolutely cannot stop doing.
No matter what you do.
No matter what I do, I cannot stop. Oh, no. Oh, you're way too excited. Oh, no.
And John will be like, oh, let me take my finished plate and put it on the island. Instead of putting it in the freaking sink. That's what it is.
There you go. Yeah,
that's fair.
It's taking your dirty plate and putting it on the island instead of in the sink. Yeah.
Yeah, for some reason...
Well, you almost made it in the sink.
Yeah, or I won't put it in the sink. I'll put it right next to the sink, and I just won't put it in the sink. Yep. I don't know why. My brain's just like...
No, I did the same thing. I did this. I did the exact same thing for a long time. I did beat that level at some point, though, Barry.
Oh, good.
Not to like brag or say I'm at a higher level than you, because. But in this exact instance, that is something that Joe yelled at me about for a long time. That I did finally break. So it can happen. Is what I'm saying. It is possible.
There is light at the end of the tunnel for me.
Yes, I believe in you for sure. Sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, I can't think of one. Also, my brain just isn't working right now. I'll come back. I will have my own, but I'll think of one down the road.
You can put it in the Discord.
Definitely something I do. Sure. Yeah, yeah.
Seafog asks, what is the best monitor configuration? I'm guessing you mean like how to have your monitors arranged on the desk. I'm guessing is what you mean. I have a triple monitor set up, and it is not very good. I'm not going to lie to you. I just don't know what else to do with it, with like the stand that I have. It is not, it's like I've got this monitor that I'm pointing at, you know, right underneath the camera. And then I've got another monitor right above that one. And then off to the side over here, I've got a third. But like this top monitor, the like lower 5% from the middle to the bottom right gets cut off by this monitor. But I can't get this monitor any lower. Like it's not... I'm looking for the same answer, basically, Seafog, if that's what you meant by your question.
I have three that are in a row, and I like it. I've never really thought about it a lot. I mean, I see, like, the really OP streamers that have, like, the huge monitor above the main monitor for chat, and they have, like, donations over here or, like, whatever over here.
Yeah.
I just like three monitors, because when I have two monitors, it was actually, like, impacting my neck and shoulders, because I would only turn my head this way during the day, so... I would literally purposefully move my chat to different monitors when I stream, so I'm turning my head different ways throughout the day. So I would personally say three, just because I don't know what else could possibly be better.
Seem like overkill, but I actually have use for all three basically all the time. But that's because my brain is broken. And then last but not least, Dreamy Martini, what is one of your favorite things that has happened at Worlds? In parentheses, Barra, please come to Worlds. You're my only hope.
I don't think I would have a specific thing. I would just say talking with Smite fans and just meeting Smite fans in general, and then also talking with all the people that I've talked to normally just throughout the year that I don't get to see that often. Just in general, just seeing everyone, hang out with everyone, as Aggro said, getting drunk with everyone. You just have a lot of similarities with everyone that you're there with, so conversations flow very easily. It's not something you really have to think about. You're just talking and just having a good time.
Yep.
I don't think I have a specific thing, because every year is just a really good world. It's just so fun to just see everyone, to talk with everyone. So I would just say the entire experience.
Yeah, I agree. My favorite thing is absolutely getting to meet Smite fans. It's really hard to explain how weird it is to have people like form a line to like talk to you, because Bear and I have talked about it before. Like we're just like dudes who are just like doing our thing. And it never ceases to amaze me how many people want to come and say hi, talk about Smite with me, get a picture, you know, whatever it is. And it's really, it's really like, I get surprised by it every single year. And it really puts how lucky we are to be in this position, like, in perspective. Yeah, go ahead, Perry.
My sickness had me so zoned out. I didn't even realize you were talking anymore.
Yeah, no, that happens all the time. Yeah, I'm with you on that.
I just said, oh, and then I just completely cut you off. Like,
No, that's good. I like it. Hit me.
Genuinely? Sorry, I'm like... No, you're good. The Mucinex is hitting different right now.
Oh, yeah.
I will say the favorite thing is the food in Arlington.
Oh, yeah, it was good.
That's probably the most... I'm so sorry. I don't know why I did that. It really wasn't that important. It really wasn't. I don't know why I did that.
I thought it was going to be a childish or immature thing that you couldn't stop doing, that you were gonna do that. That's super funny.
Oh, okay. All right,
we've got to call it here for Bear's health sake. Oh, one last thing. Oh my god, I did it! I should have waited for you to say something. Then I should have done it. That would have been even better. Okay, we are regardless. Of the plan of the podcast, we have been wanting to do one of the interactive AMA episodes again, where you can get a ticket and call into the show and be live on the show to ask us these questions. Those are some of our favorite episodes. But especially if, you know, Barry decides he does want to take a step back, we do want to do one of those before... His reign on the podcast, so to speak, is over, if it does end up being that way. So we have to nail down a date. It won't be next week because we want to give people time to, like, get tickets and all that kind of stuff if we do it. But maybe 2 weeks from now, maybe 3 weeks from now, all that kind of stuff. We will be posting about it. We'll talk about it next week. We should have some more details for you then. I believe that... Patreon supporters will either get tickets for free or at a heavy discount. So that means it is a great time to go to patreon.com/backliners and hop in there, not just for my link to my emo podcast or podcast, my emo podcast, my emo playlist, but it's a benefit there of doing that. So my god, just two shots you in arena. Okay, we gotta end the podcast quick before Derby gets too mad at me. All right, that's it for now. We'll be back next week with more news on that episode, potentially the future, potentially not the future, potentially the past. Maybe we'll be okay. I can't start going down that route. BaRRa, I'll mercy kill us. You know what to do.
Bye.
Oh, I should have gone, right in the middle of your bye.
That would have been perfect.
That would have been clean.
Holy, I'm so dizzy.